two speakers this afternoon as well, and the first of those is Vinciane de Roche. She did her undergraduate studies at the University of Liège and received a doctorate from the same university in 1992. And she has henceforth, she was employed as a researcher with the Fonds National de la Recherche Scientifique in Belgium. And in a few weeks, or it is in 1 week time, she will give her inauguration lecture at the Collège de France in Paris, where she will take up the chair on religion, history, and society of the ancient Greek world. And everything she does there will be on YouTube, she told me, so you can fill up your time with that. Vinciane Pinard-Delforge has worked and published extensively on Greek religion. I'm sure you're all very familiar with the work. Her monographs deals with goddesses like Aphrodite and Hera, but also our all-time favorite Pausanias. She has edited a number of symposia, written papers on deities, rituals, and cult personnel. And she's also the instigator of the CGNR, the Collection of Greek Ritual Norms, a database fully open access of Greek inscriptions dealing with religion and ritual practices, which provides original texts, translations in French and English, and an extensive commentary. And Vinciane not only edits, but I would really say that she is the journal Kairos. And she will speak to us about to be popular or not to be, Nilsson's Greek folk religion and optimism.
We are immediately confronted with the idea of a gradual evolution revolution that starts in primitive culture and progresses till the highest summits of religious beliefs and conceptions. In a large amount of works addressing religion, written during the second half of the 19th century and the early 20th century, humankind was supposed to have gone through various necessary stages of religious development. For decades, the evolutionary perspective was one of the most persistent schemes of analysis in the history of religion. More or less implicitly, Christianity or science, and both with an initial capital letter, were placed at the end of the religious road of humanity. A teleological view assumed, for instance, by scholars whose methods were as different as those of the linguist Friedrich Max Müller and the founder of Victorian anthropology, Edward Burne Tyler. Even Émile Durkheim, opening new paths of investigation and outlining the territory of the French sociological school, did not escape evolutionary views in his masterwork, Les formes élémentaires de la vie religieuse, published in 1912 with the subtitle Le système totémique en Australie, as you see on the screen. Intimately interwoven with comparison, evolutionary approaches of the 7th and early 20th century were supposed to generate further progress in the knowledge of the origin as well as the future of religion in the singular this time. Exotic primitive cultures were expected to give clues for identifying the emergence of religion as such, be dislocated in social projection as in Durkheim's view, in some inaccurate or naive interpretations of natural and human phenomena, in an inadequacy of language, that was the point by Max Müller, or in the awe-inspiring world. In this respect, what one called popular traditions or rituals were regularly considered as the relics of a distant past, which could be seen as untouched by the course of time, or on the contrary, as degenerative products of superstition. In both cases, the popular and the primitive were connected to various extents according to each scholar addressing these issues. Another element can be added to the picture of this period, which is the notion of irrationality, evaluated both negatively and positively. In a negative point of view, irrationality is considered as the opposite of reason, as what is absurd or illogical. The assessment of primitive cultures or savage peoples have been made according to this framework for a long time, at least since the Enlightenment. And a beautiful example of this view is the little essay published in France by Bernard de Fontenelle in 1724, and entitled, as you see on the screen, De l'origine des fables. The terms irrationality or irrational do not occur in the text, but a range of words are used in French to identify the strange productions of the human mind and the beginning of history, and we find in French des chimères, des rêveries, des absurdités ridicules et grossières, de l'ignorance, de l'imagination, which are opposed to reason. A history of the fables is nothing else than, and I quote Bernard de Fontenelle, l'histoire des erreurs de l'esprit humain. In this perspective, the absurdities witnessed in ancient mythology and religion are to be situated at the same stage of the history of the failures of human mind as what is attested among contemporary savages. 30 years later, The Natural History of Religion by David Hume still opposed reason and absurdity. But the author crossed the limit between past and present. The notion of popular was therefore used to describe theism as such. In ancient polytheism, considered as the primary religion of man, as well as in monotheism, and it was new. Popular theologies were globally opposed to philosophical reason because all theologies have, and I quote David Hume, a kind of appetite, for absurdity and contradiction. Here are the seeds in the 18th century with David Hume and De Fontenelle. Here are the seeds of a two-tiered model of religious experience. On the one hand, the intellectual leadership of people exercising their reason. On the other, the religious life of a large part of the communities relegated to the realm of popular beliefs and superstition. I don't have the time to address the positive side of irrationality, but it was with the figure of Rudolf Otto. I don't have time to go there. So, second point. The study of ancient Greek religion and Nielsen's work did not escape the main trends of the history of religion at the end of the 19th century and in the first two decades of the following century. Nielsen's first general book on the topic, as we saw this morning, published in 1921 in Swedish, and I don't even try to pronounce the title, is an interesting reagent for understanding some aspect of the debates in the field at this time. In 1925, as John reminded it this morning, the book was translated into English as a history of Greek religion and prefaced by the great British scholar James George Frazer. In some sense, this book forms the basis of what would become the monumental Geschichte der griechischen Religion. In parallel, Nielsen wrote a paper on primitive time reckoning, an ethnographic exploration made to illuminate his study of the Greek calendar, followed by papers about Swedish folklore, as well as about the prehistory of Christmas celebrations. Nielsen's work was continuously focused on Greek religion, with a masterly command of all the aspects of his field of research. But his interest, and I think that it was Gunnar who reminded this morning in the introduction, his interest in ethnography and folklore gives us important clues for understanding the way he addressed the Greek issues as far as religion is concerned. The second chapter of the short history of Greek religion is entitled, and John invoked the table of content of this book this morning, so the second chapter is entitled Primitive Belief and Ritual, and it brings together the two parts of investigation I mentioned earlier, ethnology and history of religion. The Minoan Mycenaean heritage is important for Nielsen, the famous picture book without text that Matthew Aeson will address here. But such a developed culture already left behind it the more primitive forms of religion, those very forms that the historian of religion attempts to unearth and bring to light. These are the words of Nielsen. Nielsen is perfectly conscious that the Greek evidence is problematic and cannot fully sustain his ambition. The method of investigation cannot be historical in the strictest sense of the word, he says, since the material dates from later post-Homeric periods. However, and I quote Nielsen, our justification for seeing in the material survivals from a religious stage which was far earlier than the Homeric or even the Minoan Mycenaean period lies in its primitive character and in the fact that it recurs among all peoples of the world, among the primitive races, as well as among the rustic populations of the countries of Europe. For supporting his view, he relies on a metaphor which I do not resist the pleasure of quoting extensively. To use an old illustration, a highly about religion is like the total vegetation of a forest. The great gods are the tall trees, which rise their mighty heights in the highest, are most conspicuous to the eye, and determine the character of the forest. But it's also easier to fell them and plant new ones instead. It's more difficult to eradicate the brushwood, which their crowns conceal and deprive of air and cannot stifle. What we are accustomed to call the lower figures of popular belief. And the grass upon the ground still more stubborn, ever the same blades springing up and the same simple flowers blooming. It's this under-vegetation of belief and custom which we shall now try to explain. The framework of reference contains several levels. Rudimentary beliefs and customs are attested among primitive contemporary people, evidenced by ethnography, and ethnological research tries to reconstruct the religious development of peoples by identifying transitional stages which should be present everywhere, from the stubborn under vegetation to the higher levels of religious production. However, Nielsen does not subscribe to some global interpretations such as totemism, which should apply to the ancient Greeks too. Without completely closing the door on some totemistic stage in ancient Greece, in this book at least, he supposed that such ideas and rites, I quote him, were transformed under the influence of a new world of ideas, in particular agrarian ideas. Peasants are supposed to be conservative, and they were so in ancient Greece just as in modern Europe. The rustic customs, writes Nielsen, have preserved many relics of an outgrown religious stage. Much more than primitive cultures analyzed by Victorian anthropology, the vivid source of inspiration for Nielsen is the European Volkskunde, documented by German scholars as Wilhelm Mannhardt and the Grimm brothers. The strong certainties and deep representation of men working the earth are at the core of religion, and all the rest, higher religion, is built on this firm and solid basis. Primitive life, as Nielsen tries to reconstruct it, does not come from far, wearing totemistic attire. It's deeply rooted in the fields of modern Europe. When he published his Greek Popular Religion in 1914, the ideas about the Greek peasant, briefly outlined 20 years earlier, are still present, and the structure of the book integrates some elements of the previous one, to which Nielsen applies the framework of popular interpretation. The premise of the book is that many parts of archaic and classical Greece, outside the leading urbanized cities, were still in what Nielsen calls a backward state. These places were supposed to preserve the way of life that had been common in earlier times, when Greeks were mainly peasants, but their religious life is at the core of what he called popular or folk religion. Nielsen adopts an intermediate position between the two main interpretive trends of his time. I have already touched upon the first, already present in 1921, but more clearly criticized in the new book. Nielsen cannot subscribe to an anthropological perspective obsessed with the supposedly most primitive aspect of Greek rituals. The so-called Cambridge ritualists, like Jen Harrison, are just behind the door. The second criticism is addressed to studies of ancient Greek religion based solely, and we mentioned this morning, based solely only on literature and philosophy. Walter Otto and his Goethe Griechenlands, or his Theologia der Hellenen, or understand Greek popular religion, we must start from the agricultural or pastoral life of the countryside, which was neither very advanced nor very primitive culturally. He then follows the figure he calls our peasant. It's very nice to read this introduction of the book. We are following the peasant and his work and his day. So in the various aspects of his simple life, by identifying the ritual activity in which he was supposed to participate, for example, in order to obtain grain, to protect his stock, and to sustain fertility. Thus, Zeus, Hermes, Artemis, the nymphs, and local heroes were considered very popular in this respect. According to Nielsen, this aspect of Greek religion was certainly not the highest, but it was the most enduring. It was a religion of simple and unlettered peasants, but it was the most persistent form of Greek religion. In the following chapters of the book, Greek popular religion and Greek folk religion, he addresses the Eleusinian mysteries, considering them as the most impressive flourishing of what was initial popular religion. Then he deals with domestic cults assimilated to popular cults, and he discusses what he calls the popular religion of the townspeople, that is in fact popular in the slightly different sense of what is suited to or intended for the general masses. And there is a confusion between the various levels in the significance of popular image. The great Dionysia and the Panathenaea were closely connected with such a popular taste. In the last chapter, he refers to superstition and magic, oracle and predictions, as practices considered particularly popular. Interestingly, the conclusion of the book refers once more to the metaphor of the grove with tall trees that can be easily removed and replaced, and an undergrowth of brushwood and grass that is persistent and difficult to eradicate. However, in this case, the metaphor goes further. The undergrowth can change only if the mother soil is changed. This took place, I quote, in ancient Greece, as it does today, through the rise of new conditions of life, industry, commerce, democracy, and intercourse between people and classes. Popular religion changes accordingly. In backward parts of the country, however, the old mode of life and the old popular religion persisted and have continued to persist down to our own day. But they are giving way again because conditions of life are once more being profoundly changed. This point of view explains why Nielsen is mainly interested in cult in his masterpiece in German. Even if the word belief in his book in English or Glaube in his work in German are not absent. However, he makes a strong distinction between the popular beliefs rooted in cult and the religious thought evidence in what he considers as high literature, their Glaube studied by Pilamowitz. The latter, either philosophical speculation or myths that he considered as a domain of little religious value, as we saw this morning. Nielsen continuously denotes two main tendencies in the study of ancient religions. First, searching for their core in obscure origins, supposedly shared by all humankind and its totemism and so on. As well as the limiting the religious experience of an ancient community to the testimony of its intellectual leaders. In some sense, later scholarship has given him due credit by contesting the scientific value of evolutionary primitivism on the one side, and on the other, in world was also a product of his time, and the peasant of his popular religion was mainly a free male citizen. Regarding primitivism, he fought against the anthropological evolutionary model exemplified by the totemistic global explanation, but in his model, his own model, because he has a model, the European peasant has essentially taken the place of the exotic primitive people. Nilsson rooted his own primitive religious stage in the agrarian past of the Greek communities, which could be uncovered and identified in backward, this is his own word, as we saw, in backward parts of the land. The obsession regarding origins, which is typical in the 19th century, was still present in his work, though in a particular register, and Nilsson was perfectly aware of it. In the letter to Professor Arthur Darby Nock on some fundamental concept in the science of religion published in 1947, he strongly advocates for evolutionism because, I quote, there is always a development, always an evolution. Even if he is opposed to transposing the series, and this is his words, the series preanimism, dynamism, animatism, animism, polydaimonism, polytheism, monotheism. So this series that you can find in anthropological work of the 19th century. So even he's opposed to transposing this from a logical to a historical basis, he writes to Nock that he can still be called an evolutionist. Not in the logical sense of the word, but for its historical implication. Regarding the two-tiered model of religious experience, in brief, popular and higher religion, Nilsson implicitly inherited the model proposed by the 18th century philosophers I mentioned before, but with an important difference. He strongly valued what he considered the common Greek religious experience, for him, popular religion. Contrary to the Enlightenment, he did not despise this level of religious practice as absurdité, ridicule et grossière, ignorance et imagination. Nevertheless, he still perceived Greece as a special case, and that's the ambiguity. Greece is always a special case because reason, logos, inherited by Western Europe, was supposed to have emerged there during the archaic period. The high Greek civilization has modified and overlapped primitive elements during the whole course of its history. For example, fabulous monster or creatures swallowing others without injuring them. Le petit chaperon rouge. I don't know the title in English. So all these stories survive only in remote regions of the mythology. The distinguishing feature of the Greek mind, its rationalism, led to a selection, a purification, and a remodeling of the two fantastic elements in the folk-tale material. The Greek myth has arisen from the folk-tale to a process of humanization. And it's not completely clear how to connect this with the popular religion. But this is not cult, only fantasy without real connection with the religion of the masses, this is his own words, in other words, with popular religion. In order to escape the ambiguities of myth and intellectual discussion about its lack of rationality, already present in ancient texts, the study of cult offers a firm ground for his investigation. Third, there is an intriguing origin of the mysteries and the preoccupations of simple peasants is the main criterion for the inclusion in the demonstration. If we cease to consider its obscure origins, do we get a better understanding of the Eleusinian mysteries by labeling them as popular? Their popularity seems to be related to another definition of what is popular, as I mentioned earlier. That is, it's the definition of the dictionary, what is regarded with favor, approval, or affection by people in general, that is the sense considered by Nietzsche for justifying the introduction of the Panathenaia or the Dionysian wisdom. Another example will give me the opportunity to widen the discussion. According to Nielsen, the cult, and still in the book Greek Folk Religion, because I take this point, the cult of the heroes, dear to my friend Gunnar, the cult of the heroes corresponded to a popular need which was so strong that it continued to exist in Christian God. It does not comment on this sentence. So it does not justify this statement, but its simplicity reference is to the cult of the saints. In fact, the scholarly treatment of the cult of the saints provides an interesting point of comparison as far as popular religion is concerned. As Peter Brown has remarked in its study of these cults, a kind of intellectual barrier and contemptuous attitude has kept the saints out of the discussion in early Christian and medieval scholarship for a long time. Considered as a form of popular religion, close to the cult of the pagan gods, they have been relegated to the realm of those naive beliefs sustained by the uneducated masses. But as timeless survivals, these cults were associated with an immemorial pagan past which was impossible to eradicate, and a stubborn vegetation. Just as Nielsen wished regarding Greek rituals inherited from the past, Peter Brown takes these cults seriously. But he does so in a completely different way. For him, these beliefs and cults were not particularly popular and to be taken as the inert sediment of the past, but rather constitute a major area of innovation in the social concept of late antiquity. Newly formed, and this is the argument of Brown, newly formed communities in all parts of the Roman Empire, led by educated people, actively promoted relations with the saints, even if inner conflicts and various levels of adherence and expectation were at stake within these communities. Mutatis mutandis, the same discourse could be held about the mysteries celebrated for centuries in the Telesterion of Eleusis. Attended by a large part of the population in Athens and elsewhere, actively promoted by educated people, the performance itself was certainly felt and lived in many different manners according to the various expectation and level of education and individual sensitivity of the initiates. But we can really see how difficult it is to encapsulate such a complexity behind the simple label of popular. If we push the ideas developed by Nielsen to their limits, the totality of the Greek religious system belongs to the category of popular religion, since the system is essentially based on traditional ritual action made by various groups and across many different social circles, from the domestic realm to the whole city. The last point. Nielsen's work was authored just before the Second World War. More recently, and thank you, referred to the skeletal structure of the belief system of the ordinary opinion, but only after a strong cleaning of artificial aspects disconnected from real life. And the same was achieved in the amazingly interesting book of 2010 on Greek philosophy. So, I repeat, and it's not only because you are here, these books are very important to anyone studying ancient Greek religion, but the criticism, the small criticism I address above to Nilsson's implicit reference to a different or higher level of religious experience also applies here, but in a different fashion. In the popular reconstruction of beliefs about the gods, and I will take the example of the gods, John Michelson makes a strong distinction between deities honored in lived religion, and you refer to this in your paper this morning, deities honored in lived religion and the deities of poetry and its tragedy in the present case. And these deities of poetry who could be considered as artificial literary creation bearing little relationship with the gods worshipped by the Athenians. As early as 1997, Christian Sauvigny-Wood had some strong objection to this kind of dichotomy, which implies that an Athenian made a complete difference between Athena on the stage of the theater and the goddess worship in the city, not to mention between Athena Polios, Athena Skiras, Athena Nikeia, Athena Nike, and so on. And I must admit, my dear John, that I subscribe to a critical remark, because if you are right in the claim that the Athenian and others consider each cultic persona of a given deity as a separate deity, then Greek polytheism becomes impossible to understand. And I will not address this point today, it's already long, but I only want to stress that for me, I take this responsibility, there are no such things as real or artificial religions, the first of which would be popular and the other based only on intellectual speculation, such as in tragedy. For me, tragedy and its audience are placed at the core of an interaction, an interactive process that encompasses various aspects of representation of the divine and which creates multifaceted echoes in the spectator minds. So I confess that when I am studying the Greek law, I take all this material, but perhaps I'm wrong. But I will come back to this at the end. As you all know, scholarship implies a succession of trends, or even fashions, in addressing certain topics. Each field of research generates successive or contesting interpretive models, and it's subject to what may be quickly defined as paradigm shifts. The study of ancient Greek religion is no exception in this process. But it can happen that supposed innovative perspectives finally end up tasting like old wine in new wineskins. The notion of popular is no longer fashionable today. And I have just explained why. I'm not completely convinced by the efficacy of this analytical tool. But something very similar has surfaced in the past two decades, which echoes some of the complaints of Nilsson. This time, the reaction does not consist, at first sight, in regretting the lack of interest in popular versus higher religion, but in deploring the omission by scholarship in the second half of the 20th century of concerns for personal and emotional attitudes to divinities, or even the neglect of belief in favor of cultic forms. And in this respect, the polis religion model, and you know what I'm referring to, it's the term polis religion coined by Christian Sauvigny-Wood, and against which many scholars today are struggling. In this respect, the polis religion model and the emphasis on the collective aspect of Greek religion chapter of his Greek folk religion entitled The Countryside, Nilsson referred to the nymphs, considered as female spirits of nature. And these nymphs were particularly honored in caves, and in 1903, extensive excavations were held at Vari on Mount Hymettus in an impressive cave devoted to the nymphs, and it's now very famous, to which Nilsson briefly refers in the following terms. It's the quotation on the screen. In the 5th century BC, a poor man of Terean origin, Archedemos, who styles himself called by the nymphs, planted a garden, decorated the cave, and engraved inscriptions on its walls. In Nilsson's view, Archedemos was necessarily a poor man, and the cult he founded was a clear indication of popular religion. Today we know that this cave is a complex sanctuary of the nymphs Pan, Charis, Apollo, and perhaps the mother of the gods. Organized by Archedemos, were added a garden and a dance floor to a cult site that had been frequented already a century earlier. The dedicant from Terra must have been a metic, whose skills as a mason and quarry worker are illustrated by a relief in the cave. This is very well known. Was he particularly poor? Probably not. And this evaluation by Nilsson may be the result of his own vision of what must be popular. But Archedemos' self-characterization as nympholeptos, seized by the nymphs, clearly attests to an individual link to the goddesses and to a religious experience forming the basis of the transformation of a pre-existing cult cave into a complex sanctuary divinely sanctioned by the goddesses themselves. Failing to find here a mark of the popular religion of a poor man, have we found instead a trace of personal religion beyond polis religion, which is the current trend? Replying in the affirmative is tantamount to projecting another culturally determined framework on the evidence. As Fritz Graf rightly wrote it in a paper about the limit of individualization, and I quote Graf, "Whether conscious or not, the choices of these people, like Archedemos, had to resonate with the wider group at whose center or in whose margin these men were. If at the margins, as probably Archedemos was since he was a stranger, they choose with the desire of inclusion." End of quotation. An individual choice, even made on the emotional basis of nympholepsy, was not tantamount to personal religion or even personal belief as such. Polis religion was full of individual choices, but the background was the adherence to a ritual framework shared by the whole community. The proof is the long-lasting frequentation of the shrine of the muse until the 2nd century CE. I do not want to underestimate the fact that in a complex society, religious practices and conceptions are clustered and distributed in different ways across the society. I'm perfectly conscious that for a very long time, literary texts were overestimated in the study of ancient Greek religion. When I started working on my own PhD at the end of the 1980s, I deliberately chose to focus on cult exactly the same point of view as Nilsson, and I was conscious of that, because I intuitively felt that the goddess Aphrodite, honored in centuries, was not only the goddess of love and sexuality, evidenced by Greek poetry, epic, lyric, or tragic. But this view was still inspired by a strict dichotomy between literary and intellectual culture versus everyday life. I progressively changed my mind, and I'm convinced today that strict dichotomies do less than justice to the various intersections between different kinds of material. Narrative traditions and cults were rooted in a shared knowledge. These were specific languages echoing in the minds of Greek people, offering modest sacrifices in their halls, attending great festivals, sitting in theaters and viewing tragedies, comedies, and telling stories to their own children. Strict dichotomies can give us the temporary illusion that we understand the various levels of the polytheistic culture, but they risk detracting and exonerating us from the need to deeply understand another culture, where poetry, tragedy, were deeply involved in ritual performance, and where even philosophy was taught in religious associations honoring deities. I take into due account the necessity of searching for the religion of everyday social exchange and the modest attestations of individual piety. But individual agency is not personal religion, or the manifestation of a belief which would be beyond powers. The picture is more complicated and much more interesting. It's time to conclude. The moral of this long story, from Nielsen's popular religion to the contemporary search for personal religion and beliefs, is rather simple. Strict dichotomies can help to consider some issues that were underestimated and deserve to be studied. And it's exactly what Nielsen did. But they missed their mark when they applied culturally determined frameworks such as popular religion or personal beliefs to the ancient evidence. And I will leave the last word to Nielsen. During my long life, I have seen so many theories of science of religion accepted as a solution of the problems, dominate and even dominate tyrannically, contested, and brought down to their proper proportions, that I have learned the necessity of criticizing le dernier cri in French in the text. Le dernier cri too. I am not inclined to fall down and pay respect exclusively to the idols of the day. Thank you for listening.
Religion, and that's why I did those books, because of the attempt to find things in there. then who is the ordinary Athenian? I mean, that's a wonderful question.
Yes, it was. And I don't have any answer.
And my the way I started all this was what I wanted to do is what one could say publicly in Athens about the gods and the divine and expect general acceptance. So you would put it in an oration, not because you were making a religious point, as you might be in a tragedy or in philosophy, but you just tossed it out, assuming the jury would accept it without any question. So I tried to collect that kind of statement. And so when I mean the ordinary Athenian, I guess you could say I'm talking about the Athenian jury man. And I'm sure, yes, it's jury and it's man. So there's limitations there. But that's kind of where it began.
But studying gods, because I did it very often this last year, I realized that I better understand the significance of a deity for ordinary people. If I convey narratives and gods, if I try to combine and to understand how they echo, I think that I'm able to understand it more. So, but in my PhD, I did exactly the contrary, because I was exactly in the same position that the Nielsen himself. No meat, please. For Aphrodite, it was a nightmare.
Right.
So only gods. And then afterwards, it was possible to reconcile it both, because they had to be.
Yeah, thank you very much for that. I very much agree on that. I have the same kind of problems. I mean, the thing is, what worries me about looking at the evidence, and I think I like your approach, is to kind of look at everything. And the relationship between different things may be complex. But I'm a little troubled by kind of saying, well, when you walk into a court and you're speaking to judges, not jurors, at any rate, those are the same people who are also sitting in Dionysia. And why are you privileging one genre as opposed to another genre? And another problem is, too, is that in the speech of Lycurgus against Diocrates, in Aeschines against Marcus, and also in Demosthenes on the false embassy, these people are in the court, but they're quoting large sections of Greek tragedies. So can we really posit a kind of real kind of dichotomy, whereas one gets at the real average Athenian, and the other is somehow, I don't know, elite, poetic, different. And to what extent, I mean, because there's a lot of kind of continuity between the two, but I've got to go back to read a little on that. And that's the thing that also kind of worries me. And also, I've been looking a lot at inscriptions. And of course, in the wonderful project, I completely agree with this. It's an absolutely superb database that you've done with Matt and also on Saskia. And I was looking at that too. And you know, each genre is a kind of is a different window onto a kind of general kind of reality. But like every window, you get a slightly different angle. And I think that we've got to look at all the angles and
don't